Welcome to this fast-paced introduction to R and R Studio. What I want to do is to give you an overview of what is possible in R and somehow show you how easy it is and how to find your own support if you want to dig deeper. To follow this course, it would be best that you try by yourself, step by step, what we are doing. And you will need two things. One is you need to have R installed on your computer, and you will need to have R Studio installed. For both, we have separate videos, so I will skip over that and assume that you have R Studio installed. Another thing which might be very helpful for you is to have a reference book. And that could be the book that you see on the screen here, the Big R book. It's a book that I just published with Wiley, and that book gives you an introduction to R itself and what is possible with R. It will deal all subjects from connecting to databases, downloading data, manipulating data, building models, verifying models, making nice reports and great interactive websites, and a lot more things. I will leave a link to the homepage of the book in the description. But for now, let's get started with R and R Studio. Okay, so R is a software, or let's say a programming language, that is really great if you want to do statistical analysis, build models, make nice reports. And so for that professional use, I think it is really choice number one. And so to get started, I really recommend that you use R Studio. You can, of course, use any integrated development environment, or if you're stubborn, you can just use VI in a terminal environment and it will do perfectly what you need. But working with R Studio gives you a lot of advantages to get started and also a lot of advantages later on when you move to more complex things. For more complex things like automated reports or interactive websites, you will see that R Studio has some support built in to get you started. Okay, so when you start up R Studio for the first time, you will have a window like this. The first thing that you see is the four big blocks in the main screen and the menu that you have here, and a second menu that sits somewhere in between. Those buttons here typically refer to the file that we have open here. And here is the window to have just a text file. And the philosophy is very much like you're building up your code here. And so while you're typing, you will see that certain things work and certain things not. And so here you keep a reference of the things that work, and then you build up your code line by line so that next time when you have to do the same thing, you have everything already prepared. And then the second window that you have here is a terminal. That is a screen in which you can type the commands in R. So R is a statistical engine, and if you use it in a console, then it just looks like this. Nothing more, just a cursor waiting for you to do something. And the thing that it could do, for example, is just being operate it like a calculator. For example, 1 plus 1 is 2. You see, that is how the environment of R itself looks like. So R Studio gives you a lot more. So for example, the file that we have open here, well, obviously there is something like new file, and then you can choose along many different things that are possible. And you can also get started with other type of things like special notebooks, R Markdown, which allows you to mix code and everything together. Okay. Right, sorry, I needed to get rid of these red things. Okay, so we have the file menu that largely relates to the file that you have open in the left upper quadrant here. It works like any text editor. And then you have specific things that relate to what exactly you are doing. If you are building a software package, well, then that menu will be interesting for you. And a lot more things. Here, environment, you see, is empty. This thing has history, so this is the commands that I just did, and you can pick the previous commands from here, for example. Environment is empty. Now, what does environment mean? Well, it's a programming language, and it's an interpreted programming language. So you don't need to compile your code, just like you would in C++, for example. And so we did 1 plus 1, but we could, for example, create a variable to which we assign the result of 1 plus 1. And when I click Enter now, you see, in the environment, we have a variable available. So that might come in very handy later when we have much more objects defined, and then we can see here quickly what those objects exactly are. Okay, so let's try to move on a little bit with R itself. So allow me to make this terminal window bigger. And what I do is I just click in this icon here, and basically the text file rolls up, and so now we have a lot more place in our terminal. So first of all, we have this A, and to see the value of A, I just type A, enter, and you see it returns the result is 2. And I can use A further, I can add 2 with it, and it is 4. Okay, so these are reasonably simple things. And of course, we have many functions built in. For example, we can ask for the sine of A, we can ask for the exponential of A, and many other things, like you would expect in any programming language, are available just out of the box. Now, R is a functional interpreted programming language designed to work with data. So one of the things that you will see is that when you start R, you have certain data that you get for free to experiment with. A database that I like very much is empty cars. And allow me to make the font a little bit bigger so that you can see better what is happening. And the way I do that is just like in any browser. I press the control button and then click on plus, and you see the letters, they get bigger. Right, so I just typed empty cars, clicked enter, and then it returns me the content of that data frame. So data frame is the two-dimensional data in R. It is your go-to type of variable for data. And two-dimensional data means something like a spreadsheet, something that has rows and columns. And the consensus, or the what we use in R, is that the columns, they tell me what type of data it is, and the rows, they are the observations. And you see the first observation that I have in empty cars is Mazda RX-4, and that car has, or does, 21 miles to the gallon. It has 6 cylinders, has a displacement of 160, 110 horsepower, rear axle ratio, weight, and so on. So there's many more variables that are available. What is very good with this small database empty cars is that it is indeed very concise. It's only 32 rows and 11 columns. And so because data frame is so important for R, there are many things that we can do with the data frame. For example, we can ask for the dimensions of the data frame, empty cars. And you see, it tells me it has 32 rows, 11 columns. Another thing is, well, at some point it might be useful to address just one of the columns. That can be done by empty cars and then typing a dollar sign. And you see, another advantage of working with RStudio is that I don't have to know that the column is named miles per gallon. It pops up in this small list, and I can just select from that small list. That is very handy when you have new data, bigger data, and or confusing names of your columns. In this case, it's pretty simple, and you see what happens if I just press enter now. it gives me only the miles per gallon. Now that is very handy because now I have something like a list, a vector, one-dimensional data. And so this one-dimensional data I can use to do many other statistical functions on, for example. So already the concept function we have seen here. The way that I was interrogating empty cars was asking its dimensions, and the way I did that was basically by using a function dim, D-I-M, and giving that function a parameter empty cars. And you see how that works. The function dim will return me the dimensions of the object, and I supply the object empty cars. So obviously there is much more possible in R, just right out of the box. You can ask for the mean of empty cars miles per gallon, and so the mean is 20 miles to the gallon. And of course you can ask things like standard deviation and many more things. And so that is really key in how you can use R and what is possible in R. R is an object-oriented language, and all functionality is available through functions. All things, by the way, are objects. So for example, we already have one object here, which is A, and that is just the value 2. But I can, for example, create another object which takes the values of empty cars, or basically a copy of the data frame empty cars. You see now what happened in my environment here. I see a little bit more. I have not only A, I have also D. And D is a data frame, so I have some information about the data frame. That gives me already some information about what is going on in D. And whereas things like A plus 2 make sense, things like D plus 2 might not always make sense. Now in this particular case it's numeric, so it will return something and it will add 2 on all the observations that I have. But a data frame is that type of data that can also have letters, strings, words. So let us try to create another data frame. So let's say, for example, we create a data frame DD. And by the way, the small arrow that I type here, I actually can replace this by the equal sign. Although I like very much the small arrow, because the small arrow reminds me that we are working with an object-oriented language and that the assignment is not a simple arithmetic operator, but an object assignment that is defined in the language. And so the way to create a data frame is, for example, data frame. That is a standard function to create a data frame. And basically what I'm going to do now is to give it the row name and then the values for that row name. So assume that I want to extract the names of the car. And so the names of the car are a little bit special. You see, when you look at empty cars, miles per gallon is a column head, so I can address it with a dollar sign. So is cylinders, displacement, horsepower, and so on. But these are a little bit aside. They don't have a header. They are not a column. They are names of the rows. Okay, no problem. We can address the names of the rows with the function row names. And the function row names takes as argument the data frame. Now, of course, I can use empty cars, but remember I have that shortcut D, so I can just use D, that will do the same thing. So this will give me the data. I still want to name that column somehow. And for example, I use car names. Here I can't use the assignment, I must use the equal sign. And so car names will become the new column. And the data that will be in that column will be the row names of empty cars. Then I want the miles per gallon. And that is the dollar sign miles per gallon. And when I execute this, you see we have a new data frame. You see that one has only two columns. It has car names and miles per gallon. And so you can see that here, or you can ask that in the terminal. DD enter will just show me the result. And so now we have a data frame in which we can address the car names as such. We could of course have added a column to empty cars. Many things are of course possible. And so now when I try DD plus 2, you will see that there are problems. In the first column, well, that was a word. You can't meaningfully add 2 with a word, so that fails. It gives me an A. An A is the keyword for not available. On the other hand, some things will continue to work. For example, I can ask for a summary of the data frame. Let's first ask for empty cars. And empty cars is all numeric, so it will all look the same. And column per column, it will summarize for me the data, and it will basically give information about the quartiles. That is what it does for numeric data. I can do the same for the data frame DD with the two columns, from which the first was words. And you see how it solves that. Well, there are different strings, and it interprets it as categorical data. That is something that you will find more in base R. You might want to use an important library which is called Tidyverse, and Tidyverse will treat such things as a string as opposed to categorical data. Okay, so let us have a look to our text file here. We have done some basic things. Another thing is that, okay, we have different types of data. We had already numbers. We had our A, that is just a number. We can use complex numbers without any problem. For example, B is 5 plus 6i. And you see, I don't type a multiplication between that I, and R will recognize that that is a complex number. And now I can do things like B plus A, and it solves that in the correct way. It has the real parts and the complex parts. Complex part for A being, of course, 0. And, of course, you can use other functions on that, like the sine, for example. All those things remain possible. You can also build very complex functions, and functions are really part of what makes R so powerful. And so function you can create with the assignment to a generator function. You see, what I mean is, for example, I just create my sum, and my sum takes two variables, x and y, and it will return the sum of x and y. Kind of a useless function, but this would work. Sorry, that is not the way to do it. That would be something like a lambda function in Python. What I want to do instead is to assign a function x and y to it, and here is then the explanation of what a function does. Typically that will come in curly brackets. It's not entirely necessary, but the curly brackets are just there in case I have more than one statement. A function with just one statement is kind of superfluous, but sometimes it might be handy. And so what this does is it takes a new object, my sum. It assigns to that object a function. So just like the letter A or the number 2, we can assign a function to a variable. And so that variable will become a function, and that function will operate as making the sum. So I have two variables A and B that I can add, and so I can ask for my sum A and B. That is how you can make your own functions. And so obviously when you're writing like that, you can have multiple lines and you can have very long functions. When you're making functions, you will want things like for loops, while loops, or more control statements like the if statement. And the if statement works, for example, as such that you have if, curly brackets, the control, and then you have, round brackets, and then what is being tested. If that is true, you have a first part, then the keyword else, and then another part in case it is false. So what this particular one does, it uses here our norm. So also most or a lot of useful distributions are built in R. The normal distribution obviously is built in. And I can ask for a random number drawn from the normal distribution with mean 0 and standard deviation 1. Of course, I can change those. And here is just the number of observations that I take. So I take one random number and compare that with 0. If it is smaller, then the return is small world. If it is bigger, big world. I will execute that by simply positioning the cursor here, making sure that that is the active window by clicking in it, then click, press the control button, and then click enter. You see the thing is executed here. Okay, a few things. First of all, you see that what it does here is cut, and here is print. These things are the same when they operate on strings, but they're slightly different. So cut will basically just dump the content of the variable, print will is basically a dispatching function that will find a function that is most appropriate for the object that you put here and then print that object. And so now I want to try it a few more times, and of course I can do that by pressing the arrow up, and that gives me the previous command. And up and previous command. And so from time to time it will be big world, from time to time it will be small world. And by the way, we have history here. You can just use this one, right click on it, copy paste, or just double click, and it appears again here, and get another try. Of course, we can automate that with our for loop. And so what I will do is I will just ask this one again and write everything on one line, which is maybe not the nicest thing to do. Or let me just modify it here, it will be more clear. So I will use this statement and I will build a for loop around it. So for a variable, you can choose which one, k in, and now I just want it to repeat 20 times. Well, in R you have to do that, so the variable k will run through all the possibilities of a vector that I supply here. I could of course create a vector. A vector is created by the function C, which stands for column. Remember, our key information and data type was the data frame, and so the column is quite essential. And the column will operate as a vector, and there is no separate vector type in R. And so I could type all the possible values that I want to use here, and then open the curly brackets, delete that second one, and then just have this function working here and format it a little bit nicer. It would look like this, for example. And then of course I need to close my for loop with this. And you see that small error sign disappears now when I close the curly bracket. Another advantage of working with RStudio, it will check if your brackets match. And now I position the cursor on the first or on the last line here, control enter, and it will do that a few times. Small world, big world, big world, big world, small world. And it's done. Another way to get that done is to just create a list from 1 to 100, and that, or to 50 for set 50, isn't it? Well, the way to do that is with a semicolon. You see, when I do this, it creates me just numbers from 1 to 50. So let me go back here and replace that vector by 1 to 50 and execute it now. And again, we have our 50 times the random try. Okay, so since we're working with data, a key feature will be to visualize that data. The first thing to start with, and let me again make this a little bit bigger so it might be easier for you to see, is the plot statement. Plot is our workhorse in base R for visualizing data. And so let me try just to provide the data frame D and see what happens. I just told you that R is a functional language, and we have some things like dispatcher functions. The function like summary, print, or plot, these are dispatcher functions. They don't do much by themselves, but they will basically select the most appropriate action for the object that I give them. Provide something like X axis and Y axis. For example, we want to plot horsepower as the X value and miles per gallon as the Y value. And then you see how it looks here. And you can see how the relationship evolves between horsepower and miles per gallon. So by the way, if you need help on your function, you type the question mark and then the name of the function. And so we want help about plot. So by the way, we have a long list of functions that start with plot. So why would there be so many functions that start with plot? Well, I told you that plot is a dispatcher function. And the way to see that is just asking for the content of plot. And you do that by typing plot, no question mark, no round brackets, enter. And then you get the content of the function. And you can do that, for example, I believe I had a function mySum. And that function, you see, looks quite different. You get the R code that is readable. Whereas here, we get something specific. But the key thing to look for is use method. That use method tells me it is a dispatcher function. That means that that plot function will try to find the best match for the object that I have given it. So, okay, we were first trying to get information about the plot function, and you just type question mark plot, and you get in that window where we had the plots. But you see the plots are still available, they are just in different tabs, and the information about the function plot tells me how to use it. That documentation is in a structured way, it always is structured in a similar form, so you can easily find back what you're looking for. Okay, another way to use plot is to provide just the names of the columns, miles per gallon, or I rather set horsepower, and then miles per gallon as the dependent variable, and then data is empty cars. Okay, sorry, that doesn't work here, that is for next command. Right, so now what we have is our okay, so we have our data empty cars, and so when we do plot empty cars, it will show us a plot of all possible combinations of all possible columns plotted in function of each other. And that is obviously a little bit big, so you might want to zoom it and see if you can still read it. However, while it might work for empty cars, because that's a small data set, for bigger data sets that is quite difficult to see what is exactly going on. Okay, so now we see how the different variables depend from each other. So if we want to explain miles per gallon, we're actually in luck, because cylinder has a nice dependence, displacement has a nice dependence, horsepower and rear axle ratio, weight of the car, number of seconds to the mile, the layout, even the layout of the motor, the automatic or manual gearbox is very clear, number of gears is maybe less clear, and then even number of carburetors also seems to have a nice relationship in function of miles per gallon. So we can choose. But let us just start with building a very simple model. And the way to do that is using a function. Obviously, R is a functional language. And so we will use a function lm for linear model. And of course, another advantage of using RStudio is that you have that yellow box popping up here with information how to use the function. So I don't need necessarily to ask for the help of that particular function. I know right away how to use it. And so the first thing that you have to supply to the function linear model is a formula. Formula means you have to tell R which is the variable that you want to explain in function of which other variable. So miles per gallon in function of horsepower is written as miles per gallon tilde horsepower. I also have to provide data, and that data is a data frame D. And you see, it reacts, it does automatically something, and the reply of R is telling me how the function was called, the intercept of 30 miles per gallon, and the coefficient of horsepower is -0.07 more or less. Meaning that for each horsepower, I lose 0.07 miles per gallon. Okay, so of course, R is an object-oriented language, so the result of that function is also an object. So what I want to do is typically store the result of that function in an object. So I create a new object lm1 and I store the result in that object. And so obviously when I do lm1 enter, it will return the same as we had here. That is just print of that linear model. However, I can also ask for summaries of lm1, just as I can ask summary of a data frame, and that already reveals more information. You see, we have information about the residuals on top of that, and for the coefficients we not only get the values, but we also get things like standard error, t-value, p-value. And now we really see how significant those values are. So the p-values are really very small, meaning that the probability that we have to reject the zero hypothesis is really very high, meaning that the probability that the intercept actually should be zero is rather non-existent. The probability that horsepower randomly shows the relationship with miles per gallon is less than 1 in a million. So we can probably trust those things. You see, the p-value is an important thing, so that is related to a number of stars. 3 stars is really very strong. Obviously, we can try to print our linear model and just throw it into the function plot and see what happens. Nothing happens right away, but it tells hit return to see the next plot. Okay, I will do that. Click return, and now we see the first plot. You see, in function of the variables here, you see the residuals. Next plot, you see the QQ plot of the residuals. And we see, okay, here is something strange, but for the rest, there is a reasonable fit. And then here, again, there is some systematic deviation telling me that that simple linear model doesn't really explain everything. That's probably in the bottom of that is relationship, where you see that for the high horsepowers the relationship is less pronounced. And you have some more plots that are automatically available. The normal extension is, well, let's try to add some variables. And so where I had here a formula, miles per gallon horsepower, I can start to add things like the weight of the car, the rear axle ratio. What else would we like to add? Well, automatic or manual gearbox, and let's see what that does. Okay, I have overwritten lm1. I should probably have used another variable, lm2, but okay, that's not too important now. We have the variable lm2, and let's investigate it. Ask the sum the summary of LM2. And let's see what happens. Well, despite the fact that they all showed a very nice relationship, the p-values are pretty small. The reason obviously being that we are almost talking about collinearity here. Rear axle ratio, automatic manual, they're too much correlated with the previous ones, so that is not a good idea to use them together in a model. So I can improve my model and say let's tip out automatic or manual gearbox and rear axle ratio because they did have no stars. And now we add the summary again, and okay, this model can be trusted. And we can do again the same with this model to plot and see how the residuals work. Seems to be slightly better, although there is still some systematic situation going on here. Much better fit, but still some outliers on the top. So it is still not complete, but it's already a lot better. Now what I would like to do is something really very simple. And actually I would need LM1 for that. I want to show you how to make a simple plot that visualizes how the relationship works. So, of course, you can do that only when you have one parameter. So I recreate LM1 here, miles per gallon in function of horsepower. And now what I want to do is to create a very simple plot that takes everything together and visualizes how the relationship works. That is what I was after. What I want to get is on the x-axis horsepower, on the y-axis miles per gallon. I want red dots for the observations, and I want the blue line for the model. And those things I can get also with a function plot. It works as follows. X values, Y values, color red, and the color red actually works together with something else to create those dots here. There is another thing, this function or variable rather PCH, that is the one that will tell me it is a full dot rounded, and you can have of course other possibilities here, and when you change those you will see that the things change. It went from dots to squares. What else is interesting is obviously the blue line. We see AB line, and AB line is a specific function that within the plot function allows me to show how the model works. I don't have to precise or recalculate the values, I just give it the value, the model as such, and then based on the model I want a blue line that is the line width of 3 pixels. I want the x-axis to be labeled as horsepower and the y-axis as miles per gallon, and that's it. And that gives me this nice plot, and I see immediately what is going on in our model. Okay, now let's move a little bit further and say we want to make more complex models. We want to make a decision tree. That's already a different story, and that is not really part of base R. So we need to install an additional library. And so the first thing that you might want to do is this line, install packages, and then between quotes, R part. What that line does is it will connect to the server that is defined in your installation and copy the library R part from there to your machine. That means that it is available to you on your machine, but not yet in your R environment. So to get it there, what you want to do is to load the library, and that is the line library R part. And so that line will load the relevant library. I will also load another one, rpart.plot, to make a beautiful visualization of my decision tree. That is not necessary, but I kind of like the way that rpart.plot works. And so, to make things easy, what you will see typically in R is that you want to fit a certain model or do a certain thing, well, you need a library with a certain name, or part in this case. That library provides a function which is of the same name, or part in this particular case. So that's quite handy. And then that if you it's about fitting a model, they will all work in the same way. The first thing that you provide is the formula. The second thing is the data, exactly in the same way as was happening for my linear model. The other things that sit here, they are a little bit more specific. You see, these are parameters that are specific to the decision tree and that you will understand if you understand decision trees. For example, method tells me ANOVA, and that relates to the fact that I'm trying to predict miles per gallon, which is a continuous variable and not a selection between ABC, for example, or male, female, like a categorical variable, or a true, false variable. Next thing that will be obvious for you is that I do not care so much here about correlations. The decision tree is not so vulnerable for these correlations. Of course, the stability of a decision tree might, but anyhow, I have my formula, my data, control enter, and my decision tree is fitted. And I have put it in a variable t, so I can ask what is in that t, and you will get the information of the decision tree. It's understandable, it doesn't look very nice though. It tells me that the first node is weight, and that weight will be selected at a value of 2.26. The ones that are smaller or bigger go in separate buckets, and then depending on which branch you are, it will be divided among other variables. Okay, so let us try to print that in a more nice way. And so I'm using this function PRP, not a function plot, although plot should work, isn't it? Plot t, and it does indeed work. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, that the function t will add some useful information here. Oh, sorry, text t. Yes, it does. So text t adds some useful information, and again, you can understand how it works. However, compare this with this. It's a little bit nicer presented with the function PRP from rpart.plot. Now, of course, you can prune the tree, give it another complexity parameter, and visualize again, and that is how the decision tree looks like. And that basically is a story of many more complex things. So, for example, you know, decision trees aren't super stable, they are very prone to overfitting, so let's try a random forest, which is basically trying hundreds of decision trees that are all a little bit handicapped. We leave out at random columns and rows and fit a decision tree on that handicapped data. But we keep all the decision trees and then let them vote. So that is what we call in machine learning an ensemble method. And we have a library random forest that will provide me a function with the name random forest, to which I have to supply a function which is a formula which is defined here, and to which I have to supply data. In this particular case, not much more. So let me just do control enter. Another thing that is interesting is a random forest. As I said, we leave at random out some columns and rows. Well, if you want to reproduce exactly the same results, you have to do this line here, set seed. Set seed sets the initial seed for the random generator. And so this number will be used to start the random generator. And if you do just set seed also, then you will have exactly the same random forest as that I have here. If you don't do that, it will still work, but you might find differences. Okay, we can print it. We have some overview information, and plot obviously does not plot the decision tree as such, because there is not just one tree, there is 500 trees and they all vote. So it's hard to visualize what is going on in a random forest. What I have instead is the error in function of the number of trees. And so I see that I seem to hit a sweet spot at around 150 trees. If I do 200 or more, that doesn't really help me a lot. So that is useful information for a random forest, and I can use that to improve the random forest. Okay, you can do a lot more things with that. Also, for example, adding columns, adding the forecasts based on the model, all that works in very standardized ways. But rather than showing that, I would like you to show neural networks. Neural networks are rather complex things, but R is very powerful and very good at making complex things very simple. It does, however, sometimes make simple things rather complex. But if you have simple things, you probably want to prefer a normal calculator or something like a spreadsheet. If you want to do complex things like fitting a neural network, you're best off with R. And again, we install a package which is called NeuralNet. Then we load the library NeuralNet. So installing the package you have to do only once. And then it is on your computer and you don't have to repeat that. And so I have already NeuralNet on my computer, so I do not have to execute this line. So I put that pound sign in front of it, then it will not be executed. So the pound sign is the way to make comments in R. I load the library NeuralNet and I fit the model with the function NeuralNet. And that is just one line work, and obviously you need a formula, you need data, and then you have more specific data for your particular model. In our case, probably the one that sits here, hidden, is a key one. Hidden tells me the number of neurons and the number of hidden layers. So I have just a column of one, meaning one layer with zero neurons. And when I plot that, you will see what it basically does. So there is just one layer with, okay, just one neuron here. You see all the input variables and you see their effect on the output variable. So at this point, I have actually recreated something like a logistic regression. Of course, neural networks, they are supposed to do a little bit more than that logistic regression. So what I want to do is to have more layers. For example, three layers with respectively 4, 3, and 2 neurons. And when I do this and then plot it again, you see that is really where the power of neural networks will shine, but that is also where their Achilles heel will be, because they will overfit your data. They will find a very good match. So things like your R squared, if you want to calculate that on your mass per gallon, neural network will outperform many other methods. But in return, it will overfit, which means that on new data, it might not work anymore. Okay, that is what I wanted to present in this very, very fast-paced overview of R.